So based on the clue, my guess is that we're going to talk about diamond mm-hmm. and diamond imitations.
Yeah. Oh, we have a bevy.
Huh. A what?
A bevy, a lot, a plethora. Oh.
Looks can be deceiving. It may take more than just observation to tell us apart, for we are great imitators.
All right, let's see. Whoa.
Oh my gosh.
That's a honker.
First impression, crazy fire.
Crazy fire. So what we're talking about with the fire is the spectral colors that you're seeing. The rainbow colors that come out of any gemstone really is what we call fire. It's really dispersion. The white light is separating into its component parts in the gem.
Do we guess what it is?
Well, I mean, we hope it's a diamond. Whether it's natural or lab grown, a diamond that size would be worth quite a bit. So what you gotta do then, you wanna try to figure out if it is a diamond, because that's gonna really, really set the value. There's other imitators. CZ and Moissanite are two of the biggest for diamonds right now.
First thing I would do is take a loop.
Take a loop.
And investigate. My hunch is that we've got an imitator here. But if this is a diamond,
right?
The first thing that you do is use your common sense.
If you see a flawless gemstone, Mother Nature's dirty. There's stuff in the ground all over the place, and a lot of it winds up inside gemstones. So what are you seeing in there?
So it's relatively clean, mm-hmm. no notable inclusions. Facet edges are super sharp, which mm-hmm. indicates it's a fairly hard gemstone. Mm-hmm. And I see some facet doubling, which means it's doubly refractive. Yeah. Diamond is singly refractive.
Yeah, a diamond, in any direction you look through a diamond, you're gonna see nice, sharp, clean facet edges. However, the most common one for doubling with diamond imitators with high dispersion would be moissanite. Since moissanite has a higher dispersion than diamonds, we can feel pretty confident that that one is a moissanite.
So, based on the clue, my guess is that we're going to talk about diamond mm-hmm. and diamond imitations. Yeah. A common question that we get is how to tell the difference between certain stones mm-hmm. and their imitations. Diamond, of course, is a popular stone, mm-hmm. and there are a lot of imitations. Some are better than others. Mm-hmm. Moissanite is one of my favorites, personally. A lot of people actually prefer this dispersion over diamond because they love the beautiful colors. It has about double the amount of dispersion.
It's a very hard stone, very durable, so it's one of the best, if not the best. All right, I opened the last one, you get to open this one.
Oh, that's nice.
Also big stones.
Some differences I've noted mm-hmm. off the bat. No fire, very transparent.
Yeah, I'm not getting any fire on that at all. Very, very clean stone. Luster doesn't seem to be that high,
no.
So I would not tend to think that this is a CZ. The cut's actually unusual too. The cut on this one is not a typical round, brilliant cut. Most of the diamond imitators that are specifically traditionally made for that have a traditional round, brilliant cut that's done for a diamond or other diamond cuts, since that's what they're trying to simulate. It's got a decent heft to it, but it's not like a lead ball.
So the crown is the part of the stone from the girdle to the table facet, so the top half. And in a round brilliant, it's generally gonna be a little bit shallower than mm-hmm. this. This is pretty high with mm-hmm. a very large girdle.
And for gemstones that are highly dispersive and very brilliant, it's really important to get that light in there bouncing around as much as possible. So the proportions on round brilliance, even between CZ and moissanite and diamond, they are different because each of them has a different refractive index, but they're all proportionally very similar.
Even in doubly refractive stones, many mm-hmm. of them don't have eye visible doubling. There are really only a few that mm-hmm. are noticeable with a loop.
I'm gonna say Danburite.
That's what I was gonna say.
Yeah. So Danburite, named after Danbury, Connecticut, is a natural gemstone, really, really beautiful gemstone. Honestly, it's more of a collector's gemstone than anything else. It has been used as a pretty good diamond imitator. The only thing that it's really lacking is it doesn't really have any fire at all.
No, so, I mean, it has pretty low brilliance too, I think.
Let's see what we've got here. Okay,
ooh.
Now there's more fire. So here we've got a noticeably higher luster on this one. We've done a video on luster if you want to take a look at that. This one has a slightly higher luster or sharper luster. It's what we usually call bright vitreous or almost subadamantine. Diamond is described as having an adamantine luster. So not quite that lustrous, just a little bit between glass and diamond. So a very similar fire to diamond. So not just over the top like the moissanite was. Yeah, that's exactly what I was about to do.
So we're looking for the orange flash that is indicative of cubic zirconia or CZ. And that's what I think we have here. The SG is like a 5.5-6, so pretty hefty. Yeah. That's an immediate giveaway. It's often in jewelry, so you can't do a heft test, but for loose stones, you can just tell for the size of the stone, it's a little bit heavier than you would expect.
To give you an idea, diamond is 3.52. This is, it's almost twice, what a diamond is. It feels like a little lead ball. Yeah. It almost feels like a little ball of metal. Its fire is actually closer to diamond than moissanite's is. It's a very durable gemstone. It is singly refractive. It's very inexpensive. So it's just one of the absolute best values for diamond imitators there are out there. Okay, so other diamond imitators, white zircon, colorless sapphire.
Lab-grown diamond,
which is not so much a simulant, it's just the lab-grown version of it. Whenever we talk about simulants and synthetics, a synthetic is a gemstone that is lab-grown and is chemically, optically, physically, it's identical to its natural counterpart, it's just been made by man rather than occurring in nature. A simulant is something that simulates another stone. So let's see what we got in here. Oh, we have a bevy.
Huh. A what?
A bevy, a lot. A plethora. This is gonna be a little trickier. We got all sorts of stuff.
That
in here.
Is trickier. Okay, so we have a pearl,
mm-hmm.
a cluster.
Mm-hmm.
I think I know what this is.
I'm really good on that one for sure. Luster looks really high on that one.
Looks decently high on this one.
Modern diamond cutting uses lasers and really great, polishing wheels and things. Older diamonds, which, you don't throw diamonds away. You might recut or repolish them, but diamond is forever, they say. So a lot of the times they kind of get recycled, especially smaller ones, as jewelry styles change or pieces get scrapped. The old way of rounding out a round brilliant diamond is called brooding, and you take two diamond crystals and rotate them in opposite directions to one another to round the girdle. That's what I was going to be looking for. There is the girdle of the stone, the outer edge of the round looks like it's been rolled in powdered sugar.
Yeah.
It's not smooth, and you don't really see that on any other stones.
I'm gonna guess topaz.
I would agree with you on that one. Yeah, let's see, what do we got?
Yag.
Yag?
Yeah.
Wow, I didn't even know we had yag. Wow, you don't ever see this stuff about anymore. Yag is mostly used in lasers now. It was used for a while, but CZ just has better fire.
It's cheaper to produce.
Singly refractive stone. I don't think there's any natural counterpart for it.
Yeah, so it's not a synthetic. It's just an artificial.
Completely lab-grown stone.
Let's talk about what we think this is. I think it has a decently high luster.
It does.
Not super fiery.
No. Now, we're looking at it and thinking you're seeing some brooded girdles there, but I'm seeing some that are smooth. I see some that look a little rough. This is, again, where I really love the visual optics. Yeah, look at that. So look at that bright point of light. Even through those tiny stones, what do you see?
Doubling.
Yeah, literally can't see it in the loop because it's not big enough really to see the doubling. So if it's doubling in there.
It's not diamond.
It's not diamond. And how strong was the doubling?
Strong.
Really strong. So zircon.
Zircon. Oh. That one's going to be difficult because those stones are
They're
so tiny.
Teeny tiny. And there's something I noticed in that one. Let me see if it's done in this one. The luster doesn't seem to be high enough for it to be diamond.
I don't think it's corundum. I think it's slightly lower than that from a luster. A 7 or 8.
Topaz or glass. Yeah, you never see the yags or GGD. So yeah, probably if it's natural, topaz.
Now these two guys.
Yeah, so here's something interesting with this. This is one simulant that we didn't talk about. It's not a good simulant, except for at a distance. Half of the side stones in that aren't actually stones. The metal was actually cast. So on these two sides you have stones, and on these other sides you have metal that is reflective, and it is reflecting some white light, but half of the stones are actually just metal formed to look like stones set in prongs.
Yeah.
Never thought of silver as a diamond simulant, but technically, sort of. So what are we thinking for the stone there?
I'm gonna guess it's not topaz, zircon, or yag. So we talked about lab-grown diamond. I don't think it's that. Corundum, glass. I'm gonna guess corundum. I don't know if it's synthetic or natural though.
Let's see.
Lab white sapphire.
Lab white sapphire.
Yeah.
All right, let's see what we got here.
Oh, pretty.
Ooh, okay.
By process of elimination.
Well, we still haven't done everything, maybe, but yeah.
I think we have lab-grown diamond.
They are very clean. So that would start me right there with you on that pathway, just because they are, whew.
So again, lab-grown diamonds are physically, optically, chemically the same as naturally mined diamonds. Mm-hmm. They're just produced in a lab. There are two ways that you can really test to see if they're lab-grown.
Mm-hmm.
The diamond shear, which most natural diamonds have an absorption line at 415 nanometers.
Mm-hmm.
Lab probably will not, but if those results are inconclusive, you can use the diamond view, which tests its cubo-octahedral structure, in which lab-grown diamonds often form.
Yes.
Whereas mined are cubic.
So with the lab-grown diamonds, again, they're chemically, optically, physically, they're identical, just the only difference is grown in a lab versus in Mother Nature. Yep, boom, lab-grown. You're right. What is
There's not
on here?
Mined diamond on here.
Oh, so what is in here process of elimination? Well, we didn't see glass, but you were saying also.
We're not saving glass for last.
I'm just.
Oh, I know that ring.
I'm seeing fire, I'm seeing high luster. High luster, high brilliance, really sharp, nice fire.
Diamond. Mined diamond. This one is an old estate piece, right?
Sort of. That one actually is a big clue for us on this one, because that one was an estate sale, sort of, that actually came from a pawn shop, the center stone. The ring itself is an old signet ring that was never cut. So the goal was to make a truly vintage princess cut stone. However, the vintage style that they wanted, princess cuts didn't exist yet. So found an old signet cut ring, cut the center of it out, and got the mounting altered to where it could have the diamond. So it's a newer diamond in a truly vintage piece.
I love that. All right, take a closer look at this moissanite. All right, so tell us what your favorite diamond imitation is. Let us know in the comments.
Like, subscribe, and ring that bell, and we'll see you for another unboxing soon.
Thanks for watching.